Today we will get started with the first general category of physics, namely Newtonian mechanics or classical mechanics. Both names are used. In general, classical mechanics might be more appropriate because Newton didn't have something directly to do with much of this category, but more like help making the foundation for classical mechanics. As discussed in the introduction of the channel, Newtonian mechanics is used to describe objects which move relatively slow, meaning less than 10% of the speed of light. Furthermore, the applicable scale is everything bigger than atoms, not including atoms. Of course, it depends on what you look at if that quantum effects become too large. So the exact region of applicability is not completely clear. At cosmological scales, the Newtonian mechanics may also start to give you significant errors. It should be clear from this that for most real-life applications, Newtonian mechanics is sufficient for many things. In this video, we will start focusing on Newton's three laws of motion. They are probably the most well-known of his equations. You will definitely encounter them in school or high school, and then go into more advanced application at university level. So without further ado, let's discuss Newton's first law of motion, which states that the net sum of forces acting on a massive object is zero. The velocity of the object is therefore constant. Thus, in other words, if an object is at rest and you do not act on the object with any force, then the object will remain at rest. Likewise, if an object is moving with a given velocity, then the object will keep moving with the same velocity unless you act upon the object by another force. In other words, an object will keep doing what it's doing if it's not acted upon by a force. To appreciate this law, which is also known as the law of inertia, let's consider a simple example with a force diagram. Consider a box on a surface. The box is not moving, thus it satisfies Newton's first law. And if we don't act on the box with any force, then the box will not move. But notice that just because the net force is zero does not mean that there are no forces acting on the box. There are two main forces acting on the box. One is the gravitational force acting downwards to push it down. But the box is solid and it does not want to be deformed by this force, and neither does the surface allow the box to pass through the surface. Instead, the surface exerts an upward force called the normal force, which cancels out the gravitational force, and thus the net force is zero and the box remains at rest. Let's consider another case with a different example. Consider an observer which sees a car driving on the road with a velocity of 40 km per hour, and we neglect any air resistance or frictional forces. Now let's draw a force diagram of this case. The car experiences a gravitational force pushing the car downwards, but the normal force cancels out this, just like in the previous case. But now the car is also moving with the velocity of 40 km per hour forward. The car will thus continue to move forward with this velocity. Now if we were sitting in the car, we would experience that the car was stationary, which Newton's first law describes what we call an inertial frame of reference, hence the frame where the object is at rest, but at rest does not necessarily mean not moving. This is all relative. This is a very important point because in principle we are moving with a great speed around the cosmos with forces acting from many places, but we don't feel it because just like the car, we are in a rest frame where the net force is zero. Alternatively, if you're accelerating, then you feel a force and you're not in a rest frame. Now we move on to Newton's second law of motion, which is arguably the most famous one, F equal to ma. Here, the force is not equal to zero, but to the mass and the acceleration of the object. Thus, to move an object with mass m and acceleration a, a force F is applied to the object. Before going any further, let's just appreciate this equation. We see from this equation that the mass in this case acts as a resistance to accelerate. Thus, the heavier the object, the greater the force is needed to accelerate. In this case, m is therefore called the inertial mass. If we consider the gravitational force acting on an object, we can write it as the force F equal to mg, where g is the acceleration due to gravity. Now in this case, m is the gravitational mass, which in principle does not have to be the same as the inertial mass from Newton's second law. Many experiments have been done to show that the accelerations of falling objects is the same regardless of the mass, thus leading one to one of the key concepts of general relativity called the weak equivalence principle, which states that the inertial and gravitational mass are the same indeed. This is convenient because if you have to go to the bathroom scale, you will measure the gravitational mass, and then using Newton's second law would be much harder if it wasn't the same as the inertial mass. Clearly, in order to have a dynamical world, we would need acceleration. If you want a door to open, you would need to apply a force to do so. For this example, let's consider the change in velocity, hence the acceleration, of the trivial task of opening and closing a door. The door is initially at rest until you apply a force for some time t1, which accelerates the door from a velocity of 0 to some non-zero velocity. Then you stop applying the force and the door keeps opening until you then decelerate the door for some time t2 in order to stop the door from opening by applying a force in the opposite direction, and the door will then be at rest again. Of course, in a more realistic case, your door hinges assert a frictional force that also slows down the door, but the idea should be clear. Finally, let's consider Newton's third law of motion, which states that if an object A exerts a force on object B, then object B simultaneously exerts a force on A with the same magnitude but in opposite direction. Thus, you write it as FA, hence force A, is equal to minus FB, hence force B. So the minus sign indicates the force exerted by object B is in the opposite direction of A. Thus, the third law states that all forces are interactions between bodies. Many things in rocket science is complicated, but in principle it's just Newton's third law. The problem of rocket science, sadly, is not the basic physical concept, but the issue of how to create and control a rocket. Nevertheless, let's consider how Newton's third law powers rockets into space. If we consider a space rocket, it has a rocket engine that ignites some rocket fuel. This process yields a huge force that pushes the rocket upwards. The spacecraft likewise exerts an equal but opposite force on the exhaust gases of the rocket. Thus, the rocket's exhaust gas is pushed towards Earth by the force of the rocket, and the rocket is sent to space by the force from the exhaust gas. I hope this video helped explain some of the more important aspects of Newton's laws of motion and why they are so useful. They can be applied to almost every everyday situation, and it's also basically rocket science. From here, we can move on to look at Newton's law of universal gravitation or some other aspects of classical mechanics. Feel free to comment on topics you would like to see, and like the video if you liked it, and subscribe for more physics videos. Stay tuned for more.